even though we know that this event has been hosted, facilitated, organized by, you know, the World Shakers International group, being led by Dr. Babarisha, we know that actually the chief host today is the Lord Jesus Christ. He's the one who has brought us into his banqueting hall and has come over us into the Lord. Can we lift our hands to him and worship in 1 minute? Let's lift our hands to the one who has brought us here, the one who ordered our steps into this place this morning. Lord, we want to thank you for the privilege to keep this date with you. You are an appointment keeping God. We thank you because you have not said to those who seek you to seek you in vain. You would not have told your people to seek you if you could not be found. We thank you because you are here. You came here before we arrived. You preceded our entry into this auditorium today. And we thank you for what you have been doing since we conveyed today. We thank you for line as being upon line and precept as being upon precept. We thank you for being so mindful of us. We thank you for instructing us. We thank you for correcting us. We thank you for equipping us. We thank you for the impartation of your spirit. We thank you for the release of grace today. We honor and we adore you. We want to thank you for what we're going to do in this session. We want to thank you because by the time this long meeting, this conference is over, our cups will be running over in the name of Jesus Christ. Thank you for the conveyors. Thank you for the son. Thank you for the entire team. Thank you for himself and his wife. Thank you for the entire team. Thank you for causing your pleasure to prosper in their hands. Pray, O God, that this Lord assignment will go from glory to glory. May the path of the just continually shine brighter and brighter in the name of Jesus. We thank you and we honor you. In Jesus' name we have prayed. One of the ways that we can celebrate God's presence is with our clap and with our shout. We've got part two from January to the 31 of summer. The Lord has kept you, the Lord has helped you, the Lord has upheld you, the Lord has your back. Hallelujah. Amen. Glory be to Jesus. Let me tell you, boy, you are marked for a blessing. You're marked for a blessing. I want to thank Dr. Lair for this opportunity to be here, his wife and his entire team for giving me the privilege to share what God is doing at such a time as this in this place. And I want to celebrate your obedience to God's call upon your life. In Acts 26 and verse 19, Paul said, I was not disobedient to the heavenly vision. Ultimately, we are all accountable to God. The Bible says in Romans 11, he and to him are all things. We came from him, and ultimately we're going to return back to him. And I want to thank you for staying the course, even when times you cannot see the inconvenience. Thank you for staying true to what God has called us to do. And today we are all here because we chose to obey God. Can we celebrate him and his heart in one time? And for everyone who has chosen to identify, you know, with this assignment, love reciprocity in life. That says that what you make happen for others, God will make happen for you. Genesis 8 and 23, the Bible says, while the earth remains, seed time and harvest, cold and heat, summer and winter shall never cease. In every season of life, we are doing two things. We are reaping the dividends of past actions, and we are also initiating and triggering new season. Please come to this season and honor all our eminent dignitaries that are here being a part of this event today. Hallelujah. I said hallelujah. I want to also congratulate Daddy for being here to witness what God is doing in the life of your children.
Amen.
There is no greater joy than to see that the children are doing well and also have the prospects to even do better than you. You know, the last miracle of Elijah was the first miracle of Elisha. So subsequent generations will be an improvement on the preceding generation. They ought to be getting better, supposed to be from glory to glory. Glory be to God. I said, glory be to God. And like Dr. Lair said, you know, you don't need too much salt to give flavor to a meal. Just enough. Just enough. So impact is not measured in terms of, you know, the number. Impact is measured in terms of the influence, in terms of the effect it's able to generate and it's able to create. As I begin our conversation, this session, Genesis 1 and verse 28, God said to man, be fruitful, multiply, replenish, subdue, and have dominion. When God said to Adam, have dominion, God was not speaking to Adam as an individual. He was talking to Adam as a species. So he was speaking to all of mankind in the first man, have dominion. Just like the ruling ability was or is not just, or was not just in the very first life. In all lives is the ability to rule on. In the same way, every bird has wings and every fish has fins. So every human being has the capacity for leadership. Every human being has a God-given capacity to exercise dominion. God said to Adam as a species, have dominion. The word dominion, it does not suggest oppression of others. It does not suggest subjugation of others. The word dominion simply means to exercise influence in a God-assigned domain. Exercise influence in a God-assigned. That means you do not decide your domain, to discover your domain. God told Abraham in Genesis chapter 12, come out of your father's house and out of your kindred to a land that I will show you. Abraham is not going to choose the place. Abraham will have to discover the place that God has assigned for him to stay or to occupy. There is a God-given space for each and every one of us to occupy on the face of the earth. There is a land that God has prescribed and pre-assigned for you to occupy on the face of the earth. A lion is king only in the jungle. If the lion enters the ocean, it becomes a victim. So everyone has his own space. In Proverbs 22 and verse 29, the Bible says, do you see a man who is diligent in his business? So two things stand out there as critical components of success. Number one, you must know your business. You must know your field. Because not every seed grows on every soil. You must know your field. You must know your business. Then number two, you must invest your passion, invest your focus, invest everything you have into that field. It is what you invest that determines what you will harvest. It is your diligence that triggers your dividends in life. It's the same law. It's a law of cause and effect. It's a law of cause and effect that says every other thing in life is a consequence. Every other thing in life is a consequence. Premised on your steps, premised on your actions. The Bible tells us in Psalm 37 and verse 23 that the steps of a good man are
long you have lived,
but how many steps you have taken.
Some people have lived for 20 years and they have taken only one step in life, one major step in life. Some have lived for less than that amount of time and they have taken several steps in life. The question I want to ask this morning is, what steps are you taking? What steps have you taken and what steps are you taking? If I'm going to talk about the leaf in Proverbs the first, the Bible said that the spider, it said the spider is a little insect, but the spider taken hold with her hands and walks her way into the palace of royalty. Let me say this to you. You can reach anywhere from where you are. You can get to anywhere from where you are right now. If you keep taking steps, if you keep moving, if you keep advancing forward. Exodus 14 and verse 15. God said to Moses, tell the children of Israel that they go forward. And a man is going to go forward cannot be looking backwards. In Hebrews 11 and verse 15, the Bible said they are mindful of where they were coming from, but they would have had opportunities to have returned back there. So that suggests to me that no matter your level today, it is not your peak. No matter where you are right now, in your job, in your career, in your pursuit, it is not your ultimate. Ladies and gentlemen, Micah 2 and verse 10, the Bible says, arise and depart, because this is not your rest. No matter how successful you are, success in life is progressing. When success becomes stagnated, it turns to failure. Success in life is progressing. So no matter how good you are, you can still break your own records. You can still better your own best. You can improve on existing performance. You can. Yes, you can. The path of the shot ought to be like a shining light, a shining brighter and brighter unto a perfect day. Thank God that we are the month of December, but the year is not over. And I believe that between now and the end of this year, you will still record remarkable progress in your life. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ. As the year is winding up, you need to step on the scale. You need to take an inventory. You need to ask yourself certain critical questions. The Bible tells us in 2 Corinthians 13 verse 5 that we ought to examine ourselves. We ought to step on the scale. We want to do an inventory, take an appraisal, do an audit from time to time. And one of the things you must do at a time like this is as you're reviewing the upcoming year, you're asking yourself questions like, what activities contributed the most to my effectiveness, to my productivity in the year that is outgoing? What activities contributed the most to my productivity, to my effectiveness in the outgoing year? Why? Because, ladies and gentlemen, success is a science. Meaning that if you follow certain principles, you can reproduce the same result anytime and anywhere. Success is a science. If you follow certain principles, you can reproduce the same result anytime, anywhere. Because, ladies and gentlemen, everything in life is governed by principles. Everything in life is not mystical. It is where thinking is shallow that superstition is high. Life is not mystical. Life can be explained. Life can be explained. Success can be explained. Glory be to Jesus. Are you with me this afternoon? Life is not mystical. Success can be explained. Glory be to Jesus. That's the reason why when you meet people who are doing well, if you can find out what is in their mind and take your eyes off what is in their hand, very soon you will generate results like they have generated results, because success in life is transferable. Let me tell you five things about success. Some of you probably might be aware of it. Number one, success in life is reachable. Success in life is reachable. meaning that God will not place success in your hand, but within your reach. Not in your hand, but within your reach. Riches are not limited to the reach of the rich. Riches are within the reach of anyone that will reach out for them. Success is reachable. A woman told a seven-year-old son, Mrs. S.B. Fuller, told a seven-year-old son, we are not poor because of God. We are not poor because of our skin color. Black is not synonymous with lack. We are poor because your daddy has never desired to reach. Success is reachable. You know, like I'm dwelling on that word. You know, life. Like I said, it's governed by principles. Glory to God. I said, glory to God. And principles have predictable outcomes. Say that with me.
Principles
have predictable outcomes. They do. Like that scripture we read earlier. Do you see a man who is diligent in his business? He will stand before kings. That's a predictable outcome. Number one, he must find his business. Number two, he must be diligent in it. There's a predictable outcome. He will stand before kings, not before mere men. Irrespective of geographical location. Location is not the limitation to your location in life. Irrespective of where you are. Irrespective of where, because the ark is the Lord's and the fullness thereof. Hallelujah. I said hallelujah.
Praise God.
So life is governed by principles, and principles are predictable outcomes. And one of such principles is the principle of choice making. The principle of choice making. The principle of choice making simply says everything in life is at an alternative in life. Please note the things we're sharing today is at an alternative cost. Otherwise stated, you are where you are today at the expense of somewhere else that you would have been. You are doing what you are doing right now at the expense of something else that you would have been doing. You are with who you are right now at the expense of someone else who would have been with. And you are becoming all that you are becoming at the alternative cost of a different narrative. At the alternative cost of a different narrative. At the alternative cost of a different narrative. There are people that are born where you are born, where you are born, exposed to the same conditions you are exposed to, but your narrative is not the same today. Is that not so?
Yes, sir.
You are going different paths in life. You don't have the same narrative. Age mates are not always mates. And classmates don't end up in the same class. So a decision is judged to be a right decision when the produced outcome is far better than the foregone alternative. Am I making any sense? So if being here produces for you a better outcome than being somewhere else, the decision to come will be judged to be a wise and a smart one. Is that also? If you got married to someone and your life turns out better, even though you had an option, but you are making that choice, you must have had a story of the man and his wife before. The man is going for a state function, and then they drive at the gas station to buy gas. And then he saw this petrol attendant who used to be a colleague of the mayor when they were in high school, and she was the first date of the woman who is now married to a man. So looking at her former boyfriend who is now selling petrol, and looking at her husband who is a mayor, she would say to herself, the decision to choose this guy evidently has produced a better outcome than the foregone alternative. Maybe if I was trusting this one now, he would have been okay. See what my life would have turned out to be. Just looking at that man at the PlayStation. So we say, decision is judged to be right when the produced outcome far supersedes the foregone because of our skin color, we are poor because your daddy lacks the motivation for a better inheritance. He has accepted the status quo as finality. He inherited it and he wants to perpetuate it. He inherited it and is doing nothing to change it. We may be offspring of the past, but we are parents of the future. And no matter what the past could have been, the future can be a compensation for the past. So success in life is reachable. Success in life is not only reachable, success in life is also available. Evidences abound that every day people are making crossovers from lack to abundance, from failure to success, from rags to riches. People are making crossovers. You don't need a visa to cross from rags to riches. You need determination. You need focus. You need ethical values. You need consistency. You need commitment. Are you following what I'm saying? I said, are you following what I'm saying?
Yes, sir.
Glory be to God.
Hallelujah.
You don't need to be born in a wealthy family to become wealthy eventually. In actual fact, only 2% of wealthy people are able to transfer the wealth to the next generation. Statistically good. You don't need to win a jackpot to become wealthy. You can't even be wealthy to jackpot. You can have money to jackpot. Having money and being rich are two different things. Money in your pocket, money in your thinking, they're not the same. So success is available. I used to sell cement in my mom's shop in the 80s. When cement sold at 70 at 3 naira 50. Today cement sells for over 2,000. And there are people who could not afford to buy a bag of cement then who are building mansions today. People are making crossovers from rags to riches. Are you following what I'm saying? Number three, success is not only available, success is attainable, meaning the success in life is an uphill task. And in life, nobody falls up, people only fall down. If you want to go up, you will need to choose to climb up. Up thrust is a deliberate initiative. Gravity is a natural phenomenon. Number four, success is transferable. It's transferable. That is why we go to school. So there are consultants here who are imparting knowledge to those who are students. And over time, the student will also graduate. And if he continues to pursue that field, at the end up also as a consultant. Because knowledge is transferable. So success can be reproduced in all of us. And if you want to become rich, never look at what is in the hand of a wealthy man. Find out what is behind his hand. What is in his mind? What is in his mind? Finally, success is affordable. Meaning that success comes at a cost. Success is not free. Nothing is free in life, not even in free time. Everything has a price. If they call it free, somebody paid for it. Success is at a cost. Remember where we started from? Everything is at an alternative cost of something else. Everything. Alternative cost of something else. Success has nothing to do with the subject you study. In every field of life, you find those who are starting performers, and you have those who are mediocre performers. In every single field of life, nobility is not in the course, it's in the attitude of the one in the course. Not in the course. There are lawyers that are charged and they're lawyers. And then there are lawyers that have reached the pinnacle of the legal profession.
Amen.
I said, by the grace of God, you will excel.
Amen.
In your field, you will not be a mobile spectator.
Amen.
You will command the giant portion.
Amen.
You will enjoy the lion's share.
Amen.
In the name of Jesus Christ. The reason why we came today is because we understand that there is no better place to incubate greatness than in the presence of God. In Psalm 84, the Bible said the sparrows have found a place to lay their young, even at your altars, O God. Even at your altar, O God. So it is in God's presence that dreams are conceived, that visions are triggered. It is in God's presence that purpose is discovered. Hallelujah.
Praise God.
Now, there is a difference between when God breathes something into you and when you just think of doing something. That is, there's a difference between a good idea and a God idea. If it is a good idea, you will have to make it happen by yourself. But whatsoever is born of God, God backs it up. If it is God's will, it is God's being. If God ordered for it, God will pay for it. Are you with me today?
Yes, sir.
If God ordered for it, God always throws his weight behind his will. Behind his will. When I was a lot younger, I wanted to be a boxer. Because I read a book by Muhammad Ali, the greatest. And I thought the road to greatness was through the ring. So I would wake up early in the morning, I'm talking about 29 years ago, when I was in high school. Wake up early in the morning and jog. Then after 2 weeks of jogging like that, I said to a friend of mine, take me to the gym. He said, well, I took someone to the gym last week and they used knuckle to clear his teeth. So I tried to picture myself as a young man that no longer has teeth. I didn't like what I saw. So the idea of becoming a boxer flew out of the window. Then came along Bill Gates and Microsoft. He said, the road to greatness now is through computer science. Then I had an uncle who was doing well in the oil and gas industry, read geophysics. And I liked what I said, the road to greatness now. I just wanted to be successful. I didn't like the idea of being a failure. Because you see, when you have money, you have options. You have money, you have what? One of my members was going to Abuja to go and do something last week, and she told me about it. I said, how are you going? You're supposed to be in Abuja at this time, and you still have to collect this document, and you need the documents for what you are going for. If you wait to collect the documents and you go by road, there is no way you can make it on time for the appointment. So I sent her money to fly. When you have money, you have what? would have been a 7-hour journey to Abuja for her. 45 minutes, looking fresh, looking composed, powered to go for an interview. Today now, she sent me a message that I've completed everything, I've been picked. I have the job now. Glory be to God.
Hallelujah.
You will find what you are looking for.
Amen.
What you seek, you will find it.
Amen.
So I tried different things until I discovered that purpose is never my decision. Purpose precedes your arrival on earth. What this gentleman has been doing is walking the path of purpose. The path of purpose. And once you find purpose, your life finds meaning. You can make money and your life lacks meaning. But when you find meaning and you stay consistent and stay on course, eventually everything you need, you will also begin to attract it. What is prosperity? Prosperity is having enough of God's resources to accomplish His will for your life. Enough of God's resources to accomplish His purpose for your life. That is prosperity. Prosperity is not having enough to feed your greed. Having enough to fulfill His will for your life. So it is in His presence. Now, I had doctor talking about the fact that God is not against you being accomplished in your field. What is important is that in that field, you are an ambassador. When you reach the heights of that industry, you can represent heaven's agenda in that industry. I believe success in life, I believe greatness in life, before it can be acquired, it has to be entrusted. Please follow the things I'm saying. Say with me, everybody who becomes extremely wealthy has an altar. You can have money without having an altar, but you cannot be wealthy if you don't have an altar. Whether to God or to the devil. Everybody who is extremely wealthy is operating from an altar. Either an altar to God or an altar to Satan. The only difference is, it is the blessing of the Lord that makes it and adds no sorrow to it. Meaning that you cannot acquire wealth except that it is entrusted to you. You have to be empowered to have it. You cannot work hard to be wealthy. You can work hard to be rich. But you cannot work hard to be wealthy. You have to be endowed with a force that is a super on the natural, an extra on the ordinary. Paul the plant and Apollos the water. Only God can give His increase. So in Genesis 27 and verse 20, the father asked the son, "How did you find it quickly?" He said, "Your God brought it my way." God brought it my way. And I believe seated here today are men and women who are thinking the kingdom. Ladies and gentlemen, we have two types of Christians. We have the Josephs and we have the Esthers. The Esthers are people who come to office without knowing why. Without knowing why. Esther was already in office, a privileged office. And they didn't know why she was there. Mordecai had to be talking to Esther about the fact that you have come into the kingdom for such a time as this. She didn't even know why. That there was a reason for her beauty, a reason why she was special. There was a reason. And I believe here today are people who are thinking, some are thinking like an expert. And some already programming themselves like a Joseph. They are not there, but they know their own course. Everything that happens in their life, they interpret it from a divine perspective. From a divine perspective. Their dream is bigger than their reality. In those days when I take castle flakes and German nuts. How many of you know castle flakes? How many of you know German nuts? Are you sure? When I take castle flakes and German nuts, I will ask for a toothpick. Because on the outside is castle flakes, but on the inside is and big blush. I was seeing where God was taking me to. Glory be to Jesus. Your mind needs no visa to travel. In the confines of your room, you can reach the edge of the earth. Once your mind has reached the place, it's only a matter of time. Your legs will get there. Eventually, I found purpose. I was working in the bank. And God told me the banking industry will give you a security that will keep you in obscurity. There's nothing wrong with working in the bank, but it was not my place. God was my place. Ben Cassie would have become a profession. But for the fact that every Thursday, he mentors 800 African-American high school student. So he devoted a huge chunk of his time to mentoring these boys who live in the projects. And for him, that was part, a critical part of his life calling aside. So, like you said, it is not leading the class, it is fulfilling purpose. It is fulfilling purpose. Hallelujah. I said hallelujah. Now, I cannot confer your purpose on you. A father cannot confer purpose on a child. I can't say to my child, because I didn't become a doctor, you must be a doctor. Glory be to God.
Hallelujah.
I said, glory be to God.
Hallelujah.
Once you find God's purpose for your life, you cannot begin to apply the principles of success in whatever field. And as I try to round off my thought with us this afternoon, like Dr. said, there is a dimension of the supernatural that must not be lost on us. In Isaiah chapter 6, Isaiah saw a vision and he saw angels around the throne of God. And these angels had six wings. With two wings, they cover their feet because it's important where you go. Where you go determines who sees you. Who sees you determines who rewards you. Blessed that thou does not walk in the counsel of the ungodly, nor sit in the seat of the scoffer, nor stand in the way of sinners, but his delight is in the Lord. The Lord is God. In that Lord, he meditates day and night, he shall be like a tree planted. Glory be to Jesus. Number two, with two wings, the Bible says they cover their faces. That talks about humility. And with two wings, they did fly. It takes two wings to fly. One wing is you working hard. The other wing is God backing you up. Enjoying the grace factor. Enjoying the blessing. The battle is not to the strong. And the race is not to the swift.
not by power, not by might, but by my spirit, says the Lord. It is through God that we do valiantly. It is by God that we leap over walls. It is by him that we run against the true power. So that I am what I am by the grace of God. How many students are here today? Can I see your hand? How many undergraduate students are here today? Can I see your hand? How many professionals are here today? Can I see your hand? I want to ask that in a very unique way, grace will come and partner with you.
Amen.
That from today, you will know the help of God more than ever before.
Amen.
That every step you take, God will amplify it.
Amen.
Do you know that the distance between Lagos and Abuja is a constant, but the time it will take to get there is relative based on your means of transportation. You can walk to Abuja. This possible. Only take time. Eventually, you may get there. Look what doesn't catch you. You can bike to Abuja. That's several stops. You can drive to Abuja. You can fly. The distance is constant. The duration is relative. When a man is born on the wings of grace, he moves at a faster pace. When a man is born on the wings of grace, he does what? Faster pace. When you are looking at the tallest building, who can tell me the tallest building in the world? Sir? Sir? In Dubai, if you are at the ground floor of that tallest facility in the world, you realize that it's possible to attempt to climb it by using the stairway, but you can also use the elevator. And the person who uses the elevator and the person who uses the stairway may both get there, but not at the same time and not in the same condition. God is a lifter. Are you hearing me, ladies and gentlemen?
Yes, sir.
What did I say?
God
is a lifter. In Psalm 3 and verse 3, he said, you are a shield for me, you are my glory. You are the one who lifts up my head. And I think that is my ultimate assignment here today. Because every arrow needs an archer. There is no rocket that can launch itself. Every rocket needs to be launched. There is no arrow that can shoot itself. Every arrow needs to be shot. Amen?
Amen.
I said amen.
Amen.
And that's why I believe that as we agree together and release some decrees of blessing on somebody's life this afternoon, God will begin to launch you forward.
Amen.
Your life will be on point.
Amen.
I said your life will be on target.
Amen.
Your life will be on course in the name of Jesus Christ. You will begin to enjoy traction in your field. You will begin to gain momentum in your field. You will begin to move at a faster pace in the name of Jesus Christ. You will begin to enjoy accelerated progress in the name of Jesus Christ. And everything you need for each phase, grace will supply it. Some of you right now, maybe in your penultimate year, some of you are in your final year, some of you are somewhere in the journey, what you need for the phase you are in, grace will supply it. Grace will make it happen. And then for some of you here, God will bring you to divine connections. It will network you with the right people, with the right relationships, in the name of Jesus Christ. Favor will happen for you. Favor will preserve you from errors, in the name of Jesus Christ. You will always know what to do. You will be taking the right steps, doing the right stuff, being with the right people, being at the right place, at the right time, in the name of Jesus Christ. You know, you don't pray to say amen. You know, amen is not an encouragement to prayer. Amen is an acceptance of the divine verdict. Amen is man saying, be it unto me according to your word. Amen is not an interlude in spiritual dialogue. No, amen is the name of Jesus Christ. Revelation 3 and verse 14 is called the amen of God. The amen of God. I say, I pray for somebody here today, the higher and higher you will go. In the mighty name of Jesus. The remaining weeks left in this year, light will shine on your path. The secrets of God will be upon your tabernacle. God will speak to your heart. Your ears will be hearing ears. The Lord will be your good shepherd. He will lead you the way you want to go. He will teach you to profit. Everyone whose role has expired in your life, God will create a big staff between you and them. You will not be slowed down in life. In the name of Jesus Christ, I pray for you that you will be strengthened with might in the inner man by God's Spirit. Where God has ordained for you to get to, you will get there. You will not be cut short in your journey. In the name of Jesus. Listen to me. Genesis chapter 11. There was a man called Terah in the Bible. From verse 24. The Bible said Terah took his children to go to the land of Canaan. Now these are the generations of Terah. Terah begat Abram, Nahor, and Haran. And Haran begat Lot. Go on. And Haran died before his father. Terah in the land of his nativity, in the all the Kadesh. Continue. And Abraham and Nahor took them wives. The name of Abraham's wife was Sarai. The name of Nahor's wife was Milk. And Terah took, can we read this together? I want to go. And Terah took Abraham, his son, and Lot, the son of Aram, his son's son, and Sarai, his daughter-in-law, his son, Abraham's wife. And they went forth with them from all the Kadesh to go into the land of Canaan. Where were they going? But where did they stop? Where were they going? I can't hear you. Where did they stop? You will get to where you're going to. They got to Aram and dwelt there. The next verse. And the days of Terah were 205 years, and Terah died with an unfulfilled dream, an unfulfilled vision, an unrealized aspiration. His desire was to get to Canaan, but he died with that desire unfulfilled. Go to the next chapter. Now the Lord had said to Abraham, get out of the country, from thy kindred, from thy father's house, unto a land that I will show thee. Look at this verse of scripture. This is an important speech. God wasn't just talking to Abraham. The Lord had spoken to Abraham. Prior to this time, is there something God has told you before now that you've not been able to do? I pray that from today you will receive grace for it. Some of you have books buried on your inside. Nobody will read the book you intend to write. Only the one you have written. Go down. I will make of thee a great nation. I will bless you. Make your name great. And thou shalt be a blessing. I pray for you that God will make your name great.
Amen.
And you will be a blessing.
Amen.
He said, I will bless them who bless you. Curse him who curses you. Isn't that wonderful? I will bless them, plural,
Because in singular, meaning those who are against you are in the minority. Those who are for you are in the majority. Isn't that wonderful? There are them who want to bless you, and there is only he who wants to curse you. 2 Kings 6 and verse 16. They that be for us are more than they that be against us. So your helpers outnumber your haters. God is the God of another chance, not a second chance. Because most of us will give the second chance long ago. Most of our parents who are living with unfulfilled dreams, but for you, the narrative will be different. Every dream that God places in your heart, you will see it come to pass. In the name of Jesus Christ, in your lifetime, you will realize your vision. Do you know it is possible to have a dream that comes to pass when you are gone? When you are gone. I went to Orlando. I went to Disney Park. But the man who founded the park was not there when it was done. By the time they finished the Disney World, Walt Disney was dead. He wasn't there to witness the dream he had becoming a reality. Martin Luther King Jr. was not alive to see a black man in the White House. He had a dream, but he wasn't here when it came to pass. But Caleb had a vision from God, a promise from God, and he would give him a mountain. And 45 years after, he was still alive when he took that mountain. Simeon in the Bible had a vision from God that he would not see death until he had seen the Lord's Christ. It is possible to be alive and see your dreams come to pass.
It's possible
to see the backbone of poverty broken from the family permanently. Are you following what I'm saying? It is possible. And I believe in your lifetime and my lifetime, we will see a new Nigeria. A truly rebirthed country. In the name of Jesus Christ. So, and I was being hosted by family. The medical doctor who was into medical tourism. And he told me a former Nigerian Senate president came to South Africa for medical checkup. And that was his first time of coming. He was hosting him. Former Senate president. And when the man got to South Africa, the man was overwhelmed by what he saw. We meet Africa. I mean, this is still Africa. And he was telling his host that it's good to come and buy properties here. And the host said, one day Nigeria will become like this. And the Senate president said, never! I was having dinner in this man's house when he relayed this story to me. I lost appetite. If the number three man in the country does not believe that Nigeria can become better, it took me 1 year to have an answer to that experience. A year after, January 1st, the following year, I saw that with the statesman and I relayed the experience. And the man laughed and said, Pastor, don't you know if Nigeria becomes like that, first class will be crowded. So, Nigeria being like this is a conspiracy of the minority. But if Nigeria changes, it will be, the top will be crowded. So they introduce the imbalance into the system. Deliberately, but whether they like it or not, the counsel of God will stand. This country will change for the better in the name of Jesus Christ. Do you know Nigerians spend 70 billion naira on foreign education annually? Thousands of Nigerians are schooling all over the world, including Ghana. A man built an ultra-modern hospital in his state. Then he had a minor accident and traveled abroad to achieve a minor accident. It is possible to be alive and see your dreams come to pass. I know that what you have seen in your mind is not what you have seen right now. But it shall come to pass.
Amen.
Every vision is by the appointed time. At the end, it will speak. It will not land. Even if it tarries, say, wait for it. Because it will surely come to pass. So as I'm rounding up right now, saying, every place that you have set as a goal that you want to reach, that you want to get to, with God on your side, you will get there. In the name of Jesus. No human conspiracy will be able to stop you. No demonic gangup will be able to stop you. Your past will not stop your future from happening. In the name of Jesus, you will scale every limitation. You will scale every wall. You will overcome every hurdle. You will arrive at your expected end. In the name of Jesus, God will take you there. He's not only the author, he's also the finisher. It's not only the Alpha, is also the Omega. Having this confidence that he who has started the good work is more than able to complete it, I say, by God, you will arrive at your expected end. In the name of Jesus, everything you need between here and there, the very present help will supply it. Before the need arises, God's supply will be waiting for you.
Mentorship takes away pain.
process of life. Takes away pain from the process of life. You don't need to have scars before you become a scar. Pray for somebody and God will connect you.
Amen.
For everything in life that is a how to. It's a how to. One of our mentors, the beginning of this year, was teaching me how to be a fast leader. There's a course of £3,000 to learn how to be a fast leader. How? To read, not in letters, but in pictures. That's the man who got the fortune.
Thank you.